Welcome all the fellows, VECTA fellows, DM candidates. This is the second lecture series of our IECTA educational program. And today we have Dr. Aparna, who is from Kokilaben Dhirubhai Ambani, Mumbai. Today she is presenting Aparna, first slide here, cardiac conduction system. And after that, I will be presenting on mechanisms of arrhythmias. After both the lectures are over, then we'll have some ECGs, which our FIECTA candidates can read, and we can discuss those. So in these two lectures, what we are not discussing definitely is ECGs due to ischemia. So MI and ischemia, we are not discussing, because that's a separate topic and a separate lecture. And also treatment of arrhythmias is what we are not discussing. We are only discussing different arrhythmias. And before that, Dr. Aparna will start with cardiac conduction system, normal cardiac conduction system. So Aparna, over to you.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dr. Aparna from Kokilaben Dhirubhai Ambani Hospital. I'll be covering the cardiac conduction system. The cardiac conduction system is the heart is endowed with a special the heart is endowed with a special system for generating rhythmical electrical impulses to cause a rhythmical contraction of the heart muscle and conducting these impulses rapidly. Only the atria contract consists of a second ahead of the ventricular contraction, which allows filling of the ventricles before the blood enters the pulmonary circulation. This rhythmical and conductive system of the heart is susceptible to damage by ischemia of the heart tissues resulting from poor coronary circulation, leading to arrhythmias and poor contractility and sometimes death. Characteristics of cardiac conduction cells is first is automaticity, that is the ability to initiate an electrical impulse. Excitability is the ability to respond to an electrical impulse. Conductivity is the ability to transmit an electrical impulse from one cell to the other. The action potential of the conduction system, it constitutes 0 to 4 phases. So phase 4 is the resting membrane potential. It basically functions with the potassium. The potassium current is the principal current and determines the resting membrane potential of the myocyte, which is usually around minus 90 millivolts. Phase 0 is the rapid upstroke or depolarization phase. It is generated by the sodium channel. Due to the influx of the sodium channels, there is a positive increase in the positivity of the leading to the action potential. Phase 1 is the early repolarization phase. It leads to inactivation of the sodium channels. Phase 2 is the plateau phase. It is generated by a balance of the repolarizing potassium currents and depolarizing calcium current. Phase 3 involves the final repolarization phase. There is inactivation of the calcium current with persistent activation of potassium currents. So this is a depiction of the action potential. Then constituents of the cardiac conduction system. This is a specialized excitatory and conductive system of the heart that controls the cardiac conduction contraction. The sinoatrial node is in which the normal rhythmical impulse is generated. The internodal pathway that conducts the impulse from the sinus node to the atrioventricular node. The atrioventricular node in which the impulses from the atria is delayed before passing into the ventricles. The atrioventricular bundles conduct the impulse from the atria into the ventricles, that is the right and the left bundle branches. The Purkinje fibers are the cardiac impulse to all the parts of the ventricles. Now, the sinusoidal node is it generates around impulse of around 70 to 80 impulses per minute during atrial contraction. The impulse is then passed on to the internodal pathway AV node. From the AV node, it enters the bundle branches and then into the Purkinje system. The sinoatrial node, also known as the sinus node, it is a small and ellipsoid strip of specialized cardiac muscle around 3 mm wide and 15 mm long and 1 mm thick. The fibers have almost no contractile muscle filament. And each around 3 to 5 micrometers in diameter. Location is in the superior posterior lateral wall of the right atrium, immediately below and slightly lateral to the opening of the superior vena cava. It is supplied 60% by the right coronary artery via the SA nodal artery and 40% by the left coronary artery. The primary function of the SA node is that of the pacemaker of the heart. It is the fastest heart rate and conduction of the RA conducts impulse to the RA and inter atrial septum and LA. The rate at which the SA node generates impulses is influenced by the autonomic nervous system. The sympathetic nervous system increases the firing rate of the SA node and thus increases the heart rate, while the parasympathetic nervous system decreases the firing rate of the SA node, thus decreasing the heart rate and the excitability of the heart. Mechanism of sinus automaticity. The sinus node provides the cardiac fibers from the with the capability of self-excitation, a process that can cause automatic rhythmical discharge and contraction. The resting membrane potential of the sinus nodal fiber is around minus 55 to minus 60 millivolts in comparison to that of the ventricular muscle, which is around minus 85 to minus 90 millivolts. The positive sodium ions from outside the nodal fibers tend to leak inside. Thus, between heartbeats, influx of positively charged sodium ions causes a slow rise in the resting membrane potential in the positive direction.
Aparna, just a second. Dr. Chandra Prakash, please put up your video. Dr. Chandra Prakash, yeah, thank you. Everyone else, please mute yourself and put up your videos. Dr. Chandra Prakash, your video is still on. Please put up your videos and audios, except Aparna. Thank you. Yeah, go ahead, Aparna.
Yes, sir. Positive sodium ions from outside the nodal fibers tend to leak to the inside. Thus, between heartbeats, influx of positively charged sodium ions causes a slow rise in the resting membrane potential in the positive direction. The RMP rises between each two heartbeats. When the potential reaches a threshold voltage of about minus 40 millivolts, the sodium and calcium channels become activated, leading to the action potential. Thus, the inherent leakiness of the sinus nodal fibers to sodium and calcium ion causes their self-excitation. So this is a rhythmical charge of the sinus node comparison with the ventricular muscle fiber. Depolarization of the SA node. The SA node, there is no stable resting membrane potential. The pacemaker potential gradually depolarizes from minus 60 millivolts with a slow influx of sodium, and action potential at threshold of minus 40 millivolts with fast calcium channels. When fast calcium channels open, there is depolarization phase to 0 millivolts. Then potassium channels open, leading to repolarizing phase back, which causes the resting membrane potential to be a minus 60 millivolts, and followed by the closure of the potassium channels. Each repolarization creates one heartbeat. The SA node at rest fires up to a point at 0.8 seconds. Then we come to the internodal pathways. The ends of the sinus nodal fibers connect directly with the surrounding atrial muscle fibers, as the action potential originating in the sinus node spreads through the entire atrial muscle mass to the AV node. Velocity of the conduction is most atrial muscles is 0.3 meter per second. It consists of three pathways. That is Bachman's anterior bundle, Wenckenbach's middle bundle, and Thorel's posterior bundle. Anterior internodal tract, that is the Bachman's bundle, it begins at the anterior end of the sinoatrial node. It passes anterior to the superior vena cava opening and descends on the atrial septum. It terminates at the atrioventricular node. The tract is composed of both ordinary myocardial and Purkinje fibers. The middle internodal pathway of Wenckenbach leaves the posterior end of the sinoatrial node. Passes posterior to the superior vena cava opening and descends on the atrial septum and terminates at the end of the atrioventricular node. The posterior internodal pathway begins from the posterior part of the sinoatrial node, descends to the crista terminalis and the valve of the IVC and terminates at the atrioventricular node. It is formed mainly of the Purkinje fibers. Then we come to the atrioventricular node. It is located in the floor of the eye, situated just behind the septal reflex of the tricuspid valve. It is present near the opening of the coronary sinus. Anatomy, the fibers are small with lesser gap junctions. They permit AV nodal delay. It has three functional regions, that is the atrio-nodal region, the nodal region, and the nodal region. AV delay occurs at the atrial nodal and nodal regions. It is supplied basically by 90% by the right coronary artery and 10% by the left circumflex. The function of the atrioventricular node is that it receives impulses from the SA node. Delays the relay, allowing atria to empty before ventricular contraction. Intrinsic pacemaker activity is of 40 to 60 beats per minute, also called as the junction rhythm. So the bundle of His is located in the upper part of the interventricular septum. It divides into the right and the left bundle of His. The right and left bundle of His consists of three fasciculi, that is the anterior, septal, and the posterior. They have a dual blood supply to the left posterior fasciculus via the left anterior descending and the PDA. The function is that they receive impulses from the AV node and conducts them to the Purkinje fibers. Intrinsic pacemaker activity is at 40 to 60 beats per minute. Conducts the impulses to the Purkinje fibers of the right ventricle. It is a narrow, compact structure, crosses to the right side of the IVS and extends along the right ventricular endocardial surface to the region of the anterolateral papillary muscle of the RV, where it divides to supply the papillary muscle, the parietal RV surface, and the lower part of the right ventricular surface. The proximal part of the right bundle branch block is supplied by the branches from the AV nodal artery on the left anterior descending artery, whereas the more distal portion is supplied mainly by the branches of the LAD. The left bundle branch block passes Purkinje fibers of the left ventricle. The LBV may divide immediately as it originates from the bundle of His or may continue up to 1 to 2 centimeters as a broad band before dividing. Left bundle branch fibers spread out over the left ventricle in a fan-like manner or a cascading fur with many subendocardial interconnections that resemble a syncytion rather than two anatomically discrete distinct branches of fascicles. As originally proposed by Rosenbaum, it is clinically useful to consider the left bundle branch as dividing into an anterior branch or fascicle and a larger and broader posterior branch or fascicle, both of which radiate towards the anterior and posterior papillary muscles of the left ventricle, respectively. The left bundle branch and its anterior fascicle have a blood supply similar to that of the proximal portion of the right bundle branch. The left posterior fascicle is supplied by branches of the AV nodal artery, the posterior descending artery, and the circumflex coronary artery. The Purkinje fibers are one-third of the ventricular myocardium. They have the fastest speed of conduction. They receive impulses from the bundle of His and conduct them to the ventricular myocardium. Intrinsic pacemaker activity is of 20 to 40 beats per minute. So the impulse conduction. So starting from the SA node, the SA nodal activity and atrial activation begins. Then the stimulus is spread across the atrial surface and reaches the AV node in approximately 50 milliseconds. There is a 100 millisecond delay at the AV node. Atrial contraction begins, followed by the impulse travels along the interventricular septum within the AV bundle and the bundle branches to the Purkinje fibers by the moderator band to the papillary muscles of the right ventricle. The impulse is distributed by the Purkinje fibers and relayed throughout the ventricular myocardium. Atrial contraction is completed and the ventricular contraction begins. So this is a comparison between the tissues and the impulse generation rate. So the SA node has a rate of 70 to 80 beats per minute, AV node of 40 to 60, bundle of FIS of 40, and Purkinje of 20 to 40 per minute. So the conduction rate of the AV node is the least, while the Purkinje system has the highest rate of conduction. Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you, Aparna. You can unshare your screen, please.
Yes.
Thank you, Aparna.
Thank you, sir.
I think understanding normal anatomy and physiology of conduction system is very important if you want to understand mechanisms of cardiac arrhythmias. So I'm going to talk about mechanisms of cardiac arrhythmias. Are my slides moving or not moving? Okay. So how we classify arrhythmias? There is one classification, it's simple to remember, we can have bradyarrhythmias or we can have tachyarrhythmias. So it can be bradycardia or tachycardia. In bradyarrhythmias, we can have sinus bradycardia, like sinus pauses, sick sinus syndrome, bradycardia, tachycardia syndrome, AV conduction block, or intraventricular conduction abnormalities. In tachyarrhythmias, we have supraventricular tachyarrhythmias, atrial tachycardia, AF, ventricular tachyarrhythmias like ventricular exosystoles, ventricular tachycardia, ventricular fibrillation, which can cause a sudden cardiac death. The second classification, more precise, can be because of two things. One, disorders of impulse formation. In that, there can be it can be divided into automaticity and triggered activity. In automaticity, we have either altered normal automaticity or abnormal automaticity, or in triggered activity, we have delayed after depolarization or early after depolarization. In disorders of impulse conduction, we have a phenomenon called reentry. It can be anatomic reentry or functional reentry. We'll come one by one to each of these. Well, Aparna has described this in detail, but just to remember that because all the arrhythmias and the treatment depends on all these relevant action potentials. So first is inward sodium current mediates rapid phase zero depolarization, then transient outward potassium current mediates rapid phase one repolarization. L-type inward calcium current contribute to the long plateau, and many outward potassium are responsible for repolarization of cardiac action potential phase 2 and 3. Now, in this conduction system, there are so many places where impulse can be generated from SA node to the Purkinje fibers, and every one of them have a different impulse or action potentials, and every one of them finally contributes to the ECG that we see on our monitor. So these are all color-coded from SA node to the ventricular muscle. And in the down, you can see all contributions of each of them corresponding to the normal ECG from P, QRS to T wave. coming to enhance automaticity, there can this can happen because of three things. One, negative shift in the threshold potential, which is shown here. Second, positive shift in the maximum diastolic potential, that is MDP, shown here. Or it can be increased rate of phase 4 depolarization. Simplest example is if it happens in the SA node, it leads to sinus tachycardia, like in physiological conditions when we exercise, or commonest pathological conditions what we encounter, hypovolemia, ischemia, or electrolyte disturbance. This is how you can see the automaticity, three different which I have described. This is a normal automaticity. This is action the threshold potential and the MDP here. When we have increased threshold voltage, like shown here compared to here, this is a normal threshold potential. This is an increased threshold potential. We have an extra action potential as shown in B. In C, we can see decreased membrane diastolic potential. So membrane diastolic potential, which is normally here, is decreased. So we again have an extra action potential than in the normal phase. And D, increased slope phase 4 depolarization. Now, what is the underlying molecular mechanism of these different action potentials or arrhythmia is, there are different types of channels which act and are responsible, and still a lot of research goes on into describing these channels. There's a possible role of HCN, that is hyperpolarization activated cyclic nucleotide gated channels, which is called HCN. There's down regulation in the SA node with consequent decrease in IF, which is funny current. I'll come to this funny current later on. Then there is a possible contributory role of NCX, that is sodium calcium exchanger. It probably causes tachycardia, bradycardia syndrome. And both these HCN and NCX are responsible for voltage clock, what is called as voltage clock of pacemaker activity. It is possible that dysfunctions of proteins involved in calcium clock mechanisms like cyanodine receptor and sarcoplasmic reticulum, ATPase, also is responsible. Now, what is funny current? The funny currents, IF, as described, their activation range, which is shown in black in the top left here, it comprises a range of diastolic potentials from minus 120 to minus 40. They determine the slope of diastolic depolarization and hence rate of the heart under controlled conditions. So these basically funny channels are the one who are responsible for the SA node activity. Although they are funny, but they do a very serious function. Coming to enhance automaticity of AV node. Is there somebody's talking with caps? Can you put up the audio, please? Please mute the audio. Yeah. So coming to enhance AV mode automaticity, commonest condition that we face are acute MI, digitalis toxicity, isoprenal administration, and recent cardiac surgery. When the discharge rate of AV node is higher than the sinus rate, it can lead to accelerated junctional rhythms. These rhythms can occur at sites close to the atria, such as pulmonary veins, SVC, crista terminalis, coronary sinus, atrial septum, and parahyacinth region that includes tricuspid mitral cannulae, leading to focal atrial tachycardia. There is a term called parasystole, which we should remember. And which we see on our ECG monitors very frequently. It is caused by presence and function of secondary pacemaker in the heart, works in parallel with SA node. There is a parasystolic pacemaker which are kind of protected from depolarization by SA node by some kind of an entrance block here. And then how you diagnose is that there is no compensatory pause. So we have an extra systole, we get a compensatory pause. If you see atrial parasystole, we just have an extra full complex or PQRS, but no loss of, there is no pause. Same thing can happen in ventricular parasystole, where you can have a ventricular extrasystole. It's called parasystole. Now coming next to triggered activity, it can be because of three things: early depolarization, which occurs in phase 2, then early here, early deep after depolarization, which occurs in phase 3 here, and then there is a delayed after depolarization called DAD. And this is how this is where all these three mechanisms act, which is shown: early depolarization in phase 2, in phase 3, and delayed depolarization in phase 4 of action potential. This can early depolarization, that is EAD, can develop before full repolarization corresponding to phase 2 or 3 of cardiac action potential, usually but not exclusively associated with prolonged action potential duration. It increases in the late sodium current, the calcium current, or decreases in the repolarization potassium current. The early after depolarization have also been associated with shortening in action potential duration occurring late in phase 3 of the action potential. And these late EADs are clinically relevant as they can occur immediately after termination of other types of tachycardia, such as atrial flutter, VT or VF. Now, this is a list of agents and manipulations that may lead to early after depolarizations. Can be slow rate, mechanical stretch, hypokalemia, hypoxia, acidosis, low extracellular calcium or potassium, low extracellular magnesium, all these antiarrhythmic drugs, phenothiazines, even antihistamines, amiloroid and barium. All these agents can manipulate early after depolarization. Now, what is delayed after depolarization? That easy to remember. They develop after full repolarization corresponding to phase 4 of cardiac action potential. The intracellular calcium overload can happen in when we have digitalis toxicity or we have catecholamines going in hypokalemia, hypercalcemia, and in hypertrophy and heart failure. So these are the conditions where we can have this delayed after depolarization. So if you see the delayed or after or early after depolarization, they are somewhat similar. Both occur under conditions of intracellular calcium overload and involve spontaneous release of calcium from sarcoplasmic reticulum. The difference in timing is timing of this release, which occurs during the repolarization phase of the action potential in case of late EADs and at the resting membrane potential for delayed after depolarization. For AF, both EADs and DADs have been implicated as a mechanism of arrhythmogenesis. So, a mechanism of genesis of DAD is high levels of intracellular calcium induce spontaneous calcium release from sarcoplasmic reticulum, activates three calcium sensitive currents, non-selective cationic currents INS, the sodium calcium exchange current NCX, and calcium activated chloride ICL and ICA. Together, they constitute the transient invert current, that's called ITI, that is responsible for membrane depolarization. If the depolarization produced by DAD is sufficiently large, the INA is activated, leading to triggered activity. Coming to phenomenon, the next one is reentry. Reentry occurs when an action potential fails to extinguish itself and reactivates a region that has recovered from refractoriness. It can be divided into two types. One is reentry that occurs in the presence of an obstacle around which an action potential can travel. It's called circus type. And second, a reentry that occurs without an obstacle, that is reflection or phase 2. Or we can divide them into different types, or two types, which is one is anatomic reentry and the second is functional reentry. And these functional reentries can further be classified into leading circle, anisotropic reentry, figure of 8, reentry, reflection, spiral wave reentry. Now, reentry involving an obstacle, which is circus type, this occurs when an action potential travels around an anatomical or functional obstacle and re-excites its site of origin. So there is action potential going around an obstacle, maybe a MI, and going back and re-exciting its origin from where it has originated. So the circus type reentry requires a structural or functional obstacle. This is what is shown in gray here, around which an action potential can circulate. The conduction of the excitation must be sufficiently slow to allow the tissue ahead in the circuit to recover from the refractoriness so that it can be re-excited. Thus, both the conduction velocity, that is CV, and the refractory period determine whether re-entrant arrhythmogenesis occurs. The length of this excitation wave is given by the product of its conduction velocity and refractory period, and must be smaller than the length of circuit in order for re-entry to be successful. Now, this green arrow here represents the normal conduction in the bifurcated pathways, which is shown in the diagram. The conduction is blocked in an area of refractory tissue here, which is unidirectional block. And if conduction velocity is slowed, then the re-entry through area of refractory tissue can occur. It's shown in the red arrow here. The classic example is multiple re-entrant circuits, which is shown in the mechanism of what happens in ventricular fibrillation. Now, what is re-entry not involving obstacle is called also reflection. An action potential traveling in the forward direction was sometimes followed by a return extrasystole traveling in the backward direction through the original route. And the stimulation of the proximal segment elicits an action potential. Its conduction across the middle segment cannot take place actively as the extracellular region is, this one is ion free. Coming to the simplest classification of first is bradyarrhythmia and second is tachyarrhythmia. So first we'll deal with bradyarrhythmias. It can be two things, either a failure of impulse generation, like is shown in B here, or failure of impulse propagation as is shown in C. So here you can see a failure of impulse generation and failures of the impulse is generated, but there is no propagation. So these are bradyarrhythmia mechanism. Tachyarrhythmias can be so many, sinus tachycardia, maybe because of physiological stress, which is characterized by increased slope of phase 4 depolarization in the SA node. They can be focal atrial tachycardia, most of them correspond to automaticity or re-entry mechanism. Then there can be atrial flutter. These are micro-entrant circuits in the right atrium. Then there is atrial fibrillation, again a micro re-entrant circuits. Then there is junctional premature complexes. Then there are AV nodal re-entrant tachycardia, ventricular tachycardia, monomorphic ventricular tachycardia, or polymorphic ventricular tachycardia and ventricular fibrillation. We'll deal with one by one. What is important also is not to just have a look at ECG and diagnose an arrhythmia, but we should also have a look at the patient's signs and symptoms. There can be so many of these when patient comes to you with arrhythmia or with the ECG with arrhythmia. You will have to ask, you need to know patient symptoms, like whether patient has chest pain, fainting, edema, feet, shortness of breath, abnormally fast heartbeat or abnormally slow beat. Patient can have cough. In extreme cases, patient even come to casualty with sudden cardiac arrest. Coming to first degree AV block. So here now we'll deal one by one each of the block. And which each of these block, I have ECG to explain and the characteristics of each block. Now what happens in first degree AV block? Here PR interval is more than 0.22 seconds. All P waves are followed by QRS. It is merely an abnormal delay of the impulse conduction from atria to ventricle, and it is rarely serious. It autocorrects most of the time. This block is located in the AV node. If this block is with wide QRS complexes, that is QRS more than 0.12 seconds duration, then there is a higher probability that the block is located bilaterally in the bundle branches. This type of first degree AV block often progresses to third degree AV block. So as long as you have a first degree heart block on your ECG without any QRS widening, you should not be worried. Just have observed it, probably most of the time autocorrects. Coming to second degree AV block, then there are two types. One is called, first is called Mobitz type 1 or Wenckebach's phenomenon. This AV node is dysfunctional such that it will not be able to repolarize adequately by the time the next impulse arrives, which is why the conduction will be slower than the previous, and PR interval becomes prolonged, as is shown here. The AV node becomes more and more exhausted, we can call it refractory, each time until it is completely refractory and blocks the atrial impulse. This is what happened here. This manifests on the ECG with the gradual prolongation of PR interval until a P wave is blocked and thus not followed by QRS complex. So you can see here a gradual prolongation of PR interval from here to here to here to here, followed by no QRS complex here. So successive prolongation of PR until a P wave is completely blocked is Mobitz type 1. The AV node then recovers after a complete block, only to repeat the cycle again. So once we have this blocked QRS here, it will recover, and again the same mechanism will follow. So this is a second degree Mobitz type 1 Venckebach's. Coming to second degree AV block Mobitz type 2. Now this is more serious than the type 1 because it is usually chronic and tends to progress to third degree AV block. What happens in this is a lot of P waves are not followed by QRS. So you have a cardiac output which is reduced if many impulses are blocked like this. The approximately 20% of these patients have a block located in bundle of His, and 80% have block located in bundle branches. If this is not autocorrected, then which doesn't happen usually, then we'll have to have an artificial pacemaker. So here you can see there are some P waves we are completely blocked here without QRS following, and the PR intervals are constant and PP intervals are regular. So that is a hallmark of Mobitz type 2. Coming to a third degree AV block, easy to understand. Here there is no relation between P and QRS. Atria ventricles are electrically separated from each other. This is called AV dissociation. It is difficult to establish a diagnosis of a third degree AV block. This is an interesting situation. Sometimes you see on your monitors that in the third degree heart block, atria and the ventricle rate is equal, and somehow P waves occur right before QRS, and you can mistake it as sinus rhythm. This is called isoarrhythmic AV block, and it sometimes simulate sinus rhythm. So third degree AV block causes cardiac arrest unless an escape rhythm occurs. The escape rhythm may have a narrow or wide QRS. So if you have all the P waves blocked, then we will have a cardiac arrest. So this patient will survive only if you have an escape rhythm like a QRS here. Coming to right bundle branch block, these are very specific characteristics of these blocks, which we must understand and remember by heart. When you see a ECG of QRS duration more than 0.12 seconds, in lead B and B1 and 2, QRS complex appears as the letter M. More specifically, the QRS complex displays RSR or RS capital R or RSR pattern. Occasionally, the S wave does not reach the baseline. The second R wave, denoted R, is virtually always larger than the first R wave. In lead V5, 6, 1 and AVL, there is a broad S wave shown here. The S wave duration is greater than the R wave duration, or S wave duration is greater than 40 milliseconds in V6 and 1. Then there can be ST-T changes in V1-2 showing downsloping ST segment and inverted T waves here. Leads V5, 6, 1 and AVL show positive T waves. So these are the characteristics by which you can diagnose right bundle branch block. Coming to left, here on this ECG, I have put a diagram where you see on the left side, you see a normal conduction and the normal ECG. And the middle strip is a left bundle branch block, and the right is a right bundle branch block. This is just to identify the ECGs and compare it comparatively how they look. Now, what happens in left bundle branch block? The hallmark of left bundle branch block is QRS of more than 0.12, deep and broad S wave in V1 and V2. So this is a left bundle time block. A lead V1, V2, there is a deep and broad S wave. The small R wave is missing or the smaller than normal. The S wave in V1 may be notched and resemble a letter W. The lead V5-6, they're broad, clumsy, completely positive and often notched R waves. See here, this is a notched R wave. Lead 1 and AVL, they're similar to V5 and 6, and there can be again STT changes. On the left-sided leads, V561 AVL shows T wave inversion, ST depression, and V1-3 shows ST elevation, positive T waves. The ST segment elevation rarely exceeds 5 millimeters. Coming to fascicular blocks or hemi blocks, there can be again two different varieties. One is left anterior fascicular block, and second is left posterior fascicular block. What happens in left anterior fascicular block is you have electrical axis between minus 45 to 90. If electrical axis is minus 30 to minus 45, there can be a probability still of LAFB, that is left anterior fascicular block. QRS duration is 0.12 seconds, but slightly prolonged. AVL shows QR complex shown here. V5 to 6 usually also shows QR complex. And lead 2-3 VF displays RS complexes here. Now what happens is left posterior fascicular block, electrical axis between plus 90 to plus 180. The RS complexes in lead 1 and AVL, the QR complex in inferior leads 2-3 and AVF here. A Q wave is mandatory in lead 3 and AVF here. QRS duration less than 0.12. Now, why these changes happen is because in left anterior fascicular block, the direction of activation is initially inferior and later superior. While in left posterior, the direction of the activation is initially superior there and later inferior. So that is why the electrical axis of both fascicular blocks are different. Coming to sinus arrhythmia, easy to remember, understand. The sinus, the heart rate increases during inspiration due to diminished vagal tone, and the opposite, that is heart rate decreases during expiration due to increased vagal tone. Sinus arrhythmia usually is not a normal finding among older individuals. This is a common finding in the younger individuals. So if you find this sinus arrhythmia in older individuals of more than 65 age, rule out MI, because this MI in this older age group can affect the SA node, and you can have a sinus node dysfunction and overlook. It can be also side effect of digoxin treatment. Coming to SA block, sinoatrial block, it can be a sinus pause, which is 1 to 2 second pause, but sinus beat again resumes, shown here. It can be a sinus arrest, which is of more than 2 seconds. It can be a junctional escape beat intervenes at 40 to 55 beats per minute. So you can only see junctional rhythm at rate of 40 to 55. There can also be ventricular escape beat at a lower rate, which is 20 to 40 beats per minute. This can happen in SA node dysfunction. It can happen in perimyocarditis, acute MI. It can be a drug side effect of procainamide digitalis, or a very well-trained athletes even can have this. Now, these SA blocks can be varied. You can see here the second degree SA block type 2. There's only one block impulse here. So you see here, this is one PP interval. Then there is a block sinus impulse here. So there is, if you see the PP interval here, there's only one PP interval, but suddenly there is two, but there is nothing here in between. So it can be a varied block. It can be second degree SA block where there are two blocked impulses as shown here. So you see here one PP interval, and then you have a three PP interval here. So these are two blocked impulses. You can again have two to one block, or different types of junctional escape beats as shown in the last ECG scan. Sick sinus syndrome is same. It has multiple manifestations on ECG. It can just show as a sinus bradycardia, sinus arrest, SA block, and alternating patterns of bradytachyarrhythmias. So it is called bradycardia tachyarrhythmia syndrome. Coming to atrial fibrillation, which is commonest arrhythmia that we face in our practice. The hallmark of AF is absence of P waves and irregular ventricular rate. The baseline, that is isoelectric line between QRS complexes, is characterized by fibrillatory waves. These are F waves. Now, the atrial fibrillations can further be classified into four or five different types. First is first diagnosed atrial fibrillation, that is you have diagnosed it for the first time or patient has experienced symptoms at the first time. Then there is paroxysmal atrial fibrillation, that is a duration of less than 7 days, usually self-limiting in majority and typically lasts for 48 hours. Third is persistent AF, which lasts more than 7 days generally and requires intervention or some drug to be given. Then there is a long-standing persistent AF. It's a continuous AF lasting for more than 12 months. Or there can be permanent AF. So there are a lot of elderly population who probably has AF on drugs but still remain in AF. Then atrial flutter. The flutter waves are typically best seen in lead 2, 3 and VF, shown here in lead 2. The exact appearance of flutter waves will depend on the location and direction of re-entry surgery. As shown in this, just for comparison, how the atrial flutter waves goes around in the RA and how the fibrillation goes in both the atrials. So the flutter waves here, as shown here in this diagram, they are negative in lead 2. This is the most common type of AF. And the flutter waves are positive in B1. They typically appear as P wave with short duration. You need to distinguish between these two. AVNRT, that is atrioventricular nodal re-entry tachycardia, it is caused by re-entry within the AV node. In most cases, the re-entry is induced by premature atrial beat reaching AV node while some fibers are still refractory. So most of the 90% of these cases, a P wave probably is hidden in the QRS complex. It is sometimes seen after QRS complex, like here, it's called pseudo S in lead 2 and pseudo R in lead V1. And then there are some rarer ECG manifestations of AVNRT, where you can have a P wave before QRS or P wave on the STT, like here. Coming to premature ventricular contractions, an abnormal wide QRS complex occurring earlier than expected in the cardiac cycle. It is caused by an impulse discharge from an ectopic focus, which may be located anywhere in the ventricles, like here. The ectopic impulse depolarizes the ventricles. Because the impulse is discharged in the ventricle, it will spread partly or entirely outside of the conduction system and thus produce a wide QRS, which has a duration of more than 0.12. So all these premature ventricular contraction again can be classified. You can have, as I said earlier, the sinus beat after a PVC occurs on a schedule due to complete compensatory pause, or you have PVCs in bigeminy. So here, every other beat is a premature ventricular contraction. It's called bigeminy. Ventricular fibrillation, easy to understand. They are ventricular fibrillation means that the ventricular basically are not producing any meaningful contractions as shown here. The ventricles just fever fast and erratically. They merely fibrillate and the absence of contraction causes syncope and circulatory collapse and lead to complete asystole if not treated. Now, what is long QT syndrome? This is again an important, although look benign sometimes, but a very important and can be a serious arrhythmia. Here, the length of QT interval correlates strongly with the risk of potentially life-threatening ventricular arrhythmias. So long QT syndrome is manifest when a long QT interval induces ventricular arrhythmia. Primary hazard lies in long QTC interval because they predispose to a very unstable polymorphic ventricular tachycardia that we call as torsade points. So QT interval normally is less than 480 milliseconds, and more than that is considered a long QT, as shown here in this diagram. Now, what happens is QT syndrome varies with the heart rate. So we need to correct those QT syndrome, interval with the heart rate, which is called corrected QT or QTC. So there are two, three different formulas which all of you should know. Either at least one of them you should know, because QT interval differs with the heart rate. So you should know what is called as QTC or corrected QT interval. Now, what is torsadi points? And literally, it means that twisting of the points. It is usually induced by premature ventricular beat occurring early in the cardiac cycle. The risk of torsadi points increases during bradycardia. It causes syncope or presyncope, but the arrhythmia is usually self-limiting within 30 seconds. If not, then you need to treat it immediately. A minority of these progress to ventricular fibrillation. Coming to some congenital abnormalities of the ECG, first is a Brugada syndrome. It may present three different ECG patterns. So there is three different types of Brugada syndrome described in the literature. The first one is the most typical and diagnostic. It features a large curved ST segment shown here. ST segment elevation and T wave inversion in lead V1 to V3. The curved ST segment elevation may resemble a shark tail. This is called a shark tail. ECG changes are dynamic in patients with Brugada syndrome. Most patients usually have normal ECG during the majority of the time. So that also you need to remember. It is responsible for many cases of sudden expected nocturnal death syndrome. So this happens basically because of abnormally slow electrical conduction in the areas of the heart, typically the right ventricle. What is J wave syndrome or Osborne waves? There are four principal causes of these waves. Namely, you'll see these waves in severe hypothermia or in patients with Brugada syndrome, early depolarization and hypercalcemia. These J waves are typically most pronounced in the anterolateral, that is V3 to V6, and in the inferior leads, 2 VAVF and 3. As I said, hypothermia, hypercalcemia, and vasospastic angina can cause this Osborne wave or J wave. What happens to ECG in pericarditis, myocarditis, or perimyocarditis? Very important these days because of a lot of patients with post-COVID syndrome have this pericarditis. You need to identify this and distinguish from MI. So what happens in pericarditis is there is ST elevation in all ECG lead. Whenever a patient presents with chest pain and generalized ST elevation, one must always suspect acute pericarditis. So lead 1 is typically spared from ST elevation. See here lead 1. The lead 1 is typically spared. V1 is typically spared. It's V1 here. Yeah. V1 is spared from ST elevation. There may be a notch in the J point. The magnitude of ST elevation is typically less than 4 millimeters. There are no reciprocals, ST depression. So this is classical of pericarditis, that you have ST elevations in all ECG leads and there is no reciprocal ST depression as in MI. So ST elevations and T wave inversion, they do not occur simultaneously. The ECG changes in pericarditis are rather static and changes slowly over the course of several days or weeks. So these remain static. This you can have even patients coming from the cath lab with maybe a coronary puncture. Slowly these patients keep complaining of chest pain continuously and show ST elevation in all these leads. So there you should always consider pericarditis and not MI. So this pericarditis you can have in so many conditions, rheumatoid arthritis, SLE, AMI, post-infarct, including Dressler syndrome. So what is called a Dressler syndrome, you should remember, uremia, patient who got radiation to the heart, trauma, tuberculosis, even neoplasm, and commonest is post-cardiac surgery, hemorrhagic. So COVID, of course, nowadays is common. You should always remember this post-cardiac surgery. Always you'll get a call from ICU after shifting the patient. That patient has STT changes. You have to identify or distinguish this from the MI. Now, what happens in pericardial effusion or tamponade? They are typically low voltage. These are enlarged ones, so you are seeing it large. But what happens in massive pericardial effusion and tamponade is you have low voltage ECG, because of large amount of pericardial effusion, the diminished QRS amplitude. And you can have electrical alternance. The amplitude of QRS complex vary from one beat to another in the same lead, like shown here. See this QRS and this QRS. This happens due to swinging back and forth of the heart in the pericardial space because of too much fluid. Then there can be a PQ segment depression and of course sinus tachycardia, which is classic with cardiac tamponade or pericardial effusion. Coming to Wolff Parkinson-White syndrome, WPW syndrome, as we all know, it is basically accessory pathways which connects atria to ventricle bypassing the AV node, as shown here. This is a normal electrical pathways, and this is what happens in the WPW syndrome. You have accessory pathways here. So what you have in ECG is short PR, which is less than duration less than 0.12. Then you have delta waves, which is a slurred upstroke of QRS, which is shown here in the arrows. There is a frequently a pseudo infarction pattern in the inferior leads and the RBBB pattern. There is another syndrome called Long-Ganong-Levin syndrome. Again, similar picture you will have, which is a short PR, no delta wave. You will find there is no delta wave here. Normal QRS and episodes of tachyarrhythmias. So you should remember these are rare conditions, but you should know these conditions when you see a ECG. These are classic ECGs of WPW. So there, I think I end my lecture now. I have some ECGs to show. Manoj, are you there?
Yes, sir. I'm here.
Now, can I have residents who can answer this, please? The final residents, Vieta, the name that you have sent me.
Yes, sir. I will ask. One second.
Is there Mahendra Prasad, Ashwant Atithan, Jebin Lal, Aparna is there, then Kaushal Patel, Joydeep Devnar. Are you guys there?
Yes, sir. Mahendra Prasad, I'm here.
Okay, so one by one, I have some few ECG to show you that you need to identify, okay?
Okay, sir.
So who is this? Sorry, your name?
Mahendra Prasad, sir.
You are Mahendra Prasad, right?
Yes, sir.
So I'll show you the first one. Okay. Now, this is a 60-year-old patient with COPD, palpitation, shortness of breath. ECG shows, this is a typical ECG pattern. Now, I've given you four A, B, C, D. These are like multiple choice questions. So please identify and let me know and why you think what is this arrhythmia. I give you 15 seconds.
Looks like multifocal atrial tachycardia, sir.
Yes, correct. And why you think that?
Sir,
why not AF?
Sir, there is presence of P wave, sir.
Yes.
And the QRS complexes are regular with some P waves. With some P waves, the QRS complexes are regular, and with some, there is irregular QRS complexes, sir.
Okay. And what are the conditions you will find this kind of arrhythmia? So what you said is correct. These are P waves of at least three different shapes. You'll see here, there are no dominant atrial pacemaker rate greater than 100. There's varying PR, RR and PP interval. This is because of enhanced or triggered automaticity. And the clinical, conditions where you find these mostly are hypoxia, COPD, CHF, sepsis. The treatment basically lies in underlying disease, treatment of underlying disease process, triggered automaticity, oxygenation, perfusion. You can use magnesium sulfate or calcium channel blockers for rate control.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, good. So who is next? This is a easier one. Who's next? Anybody there other than you? Aparna, you can. Aparna, you there? Aparna, you can see this ECG.
Yes,
can you identify, please? I have even written. You got the answer there. Anyway. So this is typical hyperkalemia. Can you see these peak T waves, which are more than 1/3 of QRS here? See this T wave, prolonged PR interval with increasing potassium serum levels. You can have widening QRS like here, or you can even have sine waves in extreme hyperkalemia. Okay.
Yes.
Okay, so I gave you the answer. You can now you diagnose the next one, Aparna.
Yes.
What is this? You can see it clearly, the ECG.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, what is it? What is different than the normal ECG in this?
U waves.
Yeah. Where you get those U waves?
Hypokalemia.
Yes, correct. Who said that? Prasad? Who said hypokalemia? Hello? Yeah, Prasad.
Sir, not me, sir.
Okay. Achha. Anyway, somebody said hypokalemia, which is correct. These are typical U waves in hypokalemia. And you can have these a small one, a larger one, even larger peak, and the largest depending on potassium levels in the serum. So this is with 3.5 milliequivalent potassium, you have a small U wave. Goes down to 3 milliequivalent, you have a bigger, then 2 milliequivalent and 1 milliequivalent. So you have a tall U wave. This is classic of hypokalemia. Why this happens is because of delayed repolarization of Purkinje fibers and prolonged repolarization of mid-myocardial M cells. Okay, so next one. Okay, now who's taking this question? Name yourself. Ashwin. Ashwant, you there?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Ashwant. Can you identify this? This is a 56-year-old presents with palpitation. This is ECG. Easier for you. What is this?
Atrial flutter pattern.
Ah, good. So why you say it's an atrial flutter, not fibrillation or anything else?
This is a sawtooth appearance of the atrial wave.
Yes, correct.
Yeah, and
So the atrial flutter with typical sawtooth pattern of F waves in lead in AVF. This is little evidence of atrial activity in lead 1. Okay. This QRS typically is normal width, all these leads, yeah. And this is because of enhanced automaticity leading to circuitous conduction and re-entry. Okay, good. So we go to next. Okay, who's taking this? Jabin is there. Jabin?
So unfortunately, it's on duty today, sir. That's why I tried contacting.
Okay. Then Kaushal Patel is there. Kaushal Patel or Joydeep? Anyone?
Sir, it is supraventricular tachycardia.
Who's saying this? Who's talking?
Joydeep, sir.
Not Joydeep. Okay, yeah. So what do you think?
This is SVT.
Sorry?
SVT, sir. Supraventricular tachycardia.
Why it is SVT?
Sir, because QRS complex is narrow. Mm-hmm. And there is tachycardia is there.
Mm-hmm. Absent AVFs.
Absent AVFs.
Yeah, correct. So that's a classical. You can call it AV nodal re-entry tachycardia with rapid rate, absent P waves and narrow QRS. So that is classical of SVT.
Yes.
Okay. How you treat this? Treat by blocking AV node, allowing normal pacemaker to resume. You can give adenosine, calcium channel blocker or beta blocker.
Beta blocker.
These are basically circuitous impulse in typically transmitted anterograde forward overflow, relatively slow AV nodal fibers, limiting the rate at 200. Okay, so next one. Who is taking this? Kaushal Patel is there. No? Okay. Prasad, you can take this, Prasad.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, tell me, this is a 14-year-old lady comes with emergency department after her husband's funeral with sensation of fluttering in her chest. She's feeling anxious. What is the diagnosis? Rate around 160. Normal axis, normal rhythm is regular. PRP not visible. QRS narrow. STT slight lateral ST depression. QTC is also normal. What do you think this is?
Sir, looks like more of sinus tachycardia or SVT, sir.
Sorry?
Junction.
No, it's
junction.
Read here. I've even given the diagnosis. Read here. PRP not visible, so it can't be sinus.
Junctional rhythm.
Yeah.
Junctional tachycardia.
This is the junctional sinus. Yeah, so when you have difficulty identifying a P wave, usually you see the rate in sinus rhythm, usually doesn't go beyond 120, but here there are no P wave visible. So it's a junctional supraventricular tachycardia. Treatment is vagal maneuver followed by maybe adenosine.
Okay, sir.
Okay, another one. Aparna, you can take this.
Yes.
Yeah. Tell me, what is this? A woman step off a long flight. She is complaining of pleuritic chest pain, shortness of breath. But on examination, her chest is clear. This ECG rate is 110. Rhythm is regular. This slight right axis deviation. PRP normal. There is wide RBVB in QRS, STTT inversion in lead 3, and QTC is normal. What is this? Any one of you can say. Anyone, any one of you. If not, Aparna, Prasad,
yes, Joy,
I will give one clue. Now, what is this? Do you know S1, Q3, T3 pattern?
Yes, sir.
What is it?
Pulmonary embolism.
Yeah, that is written there. But what is S1, Q3, T3 pattern? Any one of you?
Sure.
So,
lead one.
Classic of pulmonary embolism. There is a deep S wave in lead 1. That's S1. Pathological Q waves in lead 3. Q3. Q1 in V3. Okay. Then there is a sinus tachycardia. There may be RBVB or not RBVB, but here there is RBVB. Then you can have a RV strain pattern with T wave inversion in V1 to V4. So this is a classic of pulmonary embolism ECG. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Okay, now there's a question. Can you diagnose MI if ECG has LBVB? Now this is a typical clinical situation that we sometimes have, that we have a patient with wide QRS LBBB, but we don't know whether patient has MI or not, because you can't probably see ST elevation depression with LBBB. So how do you diagnose basically MI when patient comes to you with LBBB? Any comments on this? Any one of you?
So unless you can see for a hyperacute T wave, sir.
What is that?
T wave, sir.
T waves, okay. Anything else? Have you heard of this? There is something called as Scarboza criteria. This is basically a point scoring system. So you have a ST elevation of more than 1 mm in the same direction with QRS, which has 5 points. Then there can be ST depression of more than 1 mm in lead V1, 2, 3. Which has 3 points. Third is little not a clear point, but ST elevation of more than 5 in opposite direction with QRS, which is 2 points. So they have given a scoring system. If you have more than 3 points, you can call it an acute MI. Okay, you need to have, it's very important to have either of the first or second criteria in the ECG, so that you can say it's a MI in LBBB. Okay, there are more criteria. Anyone knows about this? This one is Scarboza. Then there is a Chapman sign and there is a Cabrera sign. Have you read this anytime? So Chapman sign is a notch in the upslope of R wave in one AVL, and there is one there. See, there's a notch here. You can see this notch in one AVL.
Yes,
and now this has a low sensitivity, but the specificity of about 90%. So diagnosing MI with LBBB has always been a problem, but there are few few of the signs and criteria by which you probably can identify. Then there is a Cabrera sign matching at the 40 milliseconds in upslope of S wave in V3 and 4. So this is V3 and V4. So you can see there's an upslope of S wave in the lead V3 and V4. But this has a poor sensitivity of 27%. So Chapman sign is what is more important, where you can diagnose MI. Okay. Okay, this is another 25-year-old female palpitation BP 117 by 12. Now, anybody can identify this? Any one of you? Give one clue. I'll give one clue for this. Now, anything? Anything comes to your mind? Any one of you? What is that in AVM? No? None of you? Okay. So this is regular narrow complex tachycardia, rate 132. There is, I'm now in reading ECG. Now this, after this you diagnose, there is a slight right axis deviation. There is a dominant R wave in V1. There is a pseudo R wave in terminal portions of QRS in V1. And there is a notching near the apex of R wave in inferior leads, which is known as Prodigy sign. Have you heard of this?
No, sir.
No? So you need diagnosis from me. Have you seen this ECG in any ASD, secondary ASDs? The presence of this sign in all three inferior leads has a 92 to 100% specificity for the diagnosis of secondary ASD. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Now, okay, this is probably the last one. Fit 31-year-old man presents for the routine insurance medical. This is ECG. Can you identify this? Anyone? Attempt at least.
Pathological Q wave, sir.
Where?
In lead three, sir.
Lead three. Pathological Q wave. I don't think so. Yes, Aparna, you're saying something? So when you need to go through a lot of ECGs to actually diagnose these ECGs, the first thing you should do is first diagnose what is a normal ECG. Okay, so this is just a normal ECG. There is nothing here. You should always see a ECG, but ask patient the history. So as I told during my lecture also, history of the patient is very important. Now, he's a patient who has come, he's a fit, routine. He just come for insurance medical. He doesn't have any other problem. So this is a normal problem. This patient has breathlessness or something else, then probably you can investigate him further. But you should always know what is normal ECG first to identify the arrhythmias, okay? Thank you. Okay, Rahul, over to Rahul.
Thank you very much, Uday. That was a fantastic teaching session you conducted, and especially the ECG strips that the students got to see at the end would help them very much during the final exit exam. So once again, thanks very much to you, and thanks goes to Dr. Aparna for appearing in this session and giving a very comprehensive presentation of the cardiac conduction system. We plan to see you again in the next edition in another fortnight. We want all the students to join the session. Okay then.
Yeah, today I think we had a better attendance than the last time. So make sure that we make it more interesting and interactive next time also.
Okay. Okay. Thank you very much, then. Thank you. Bye. Bye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.